So I've spent many years in baseball ballparks, either as a fan or in the front office. And it's always amazing to me the buzz that kind of is created at certain times of year. So you have opening day when everything is sort of new and hope springs eternal for every team. And then you have sort of the all-star game where all the big name players kind of get together. And then you have the playoff push and the playoffs where people want to crowd into the stadiums because they want to be a part of something live and something that's happening and something that's exciting. And as somebody that worked in the front office in minor league baseball, it always amazed me when you would go into the ballpark and all of a sudden you would just see a crowd of people sort of gang rush over to one area, and you could almost tell that that's the exact moment that the players would start to come out on the field, because people were looking for autographs and people wanted to see the players and get pictures with the players. And, you know, when they had their uniforms on, it didn't matter really almost who they were sometimes. You know, people were kind of drawn to them. But some of those players, if they were to kind of take off their uniform and just kind of be out in the crowd, probably wouldn't have gotten noticed so much. But the people that drew the biggest crowds, I always saw, were either the veteran players that people knew who had already proven themselves, were some of them superstars in their own right, or the up-and-comers, those who were talked about as being the next big thing. You know, they were the blue-chip prospects, the can't-miss, the guys who are going to be in the pros in just 1 or 2 years and probably or could be have the chance to be Hall of Famers. But there was whispers about those folks. You know, it's like, oh, you know, there's so-and-so. You know, he's that next big third baseman. And those would be the people that would draw the biggest crowds. You know, and it's amazing that over 2,000 years have gone by and not much has changed in that respect. Because in Jesus' day, the people that people showed up for were either those big-name players, like a Pontius Pilate, a governor who was coming into the territory, or the up-and-comers, those that people had been whispering about, talking about, those that people wanted to see for themselves who these people were. And Jesus was one of those people. Now, Jesus taught in Galilee, which was about almost 8 days' walk from Jerusalem. But every year in Jerusalem, they celebrated the Passover festival. And this was a celebration to celebrate the Israelites' freedom from Egypt when Moses led them out through God's power. And so every year they would gather like we do for Christmas and Easter and other big days in the life of the church, and they would gather them together to celebrate that particular big day in the life of the Jewish people. And it wasn't just one day. It was a week-long festival. In fact, multiple weeks sometimes that people would get there, and the Jerusalem would go from about 10,000 people to over 100,000 people. So it's kind of like, think about how, you know, Minneapolis hosted the Final Four last week. You know, all of a sudden there'd just be this mass influx of people into the city. And so they are waiting to see the big players and the up-and-comers. And some people made their way to the main gate in Jerusalem. And there's 8 gates surrounding the city. And there's a main gate that the big name players would come through. But their parades, as Pam talked to our kids about, were a lot different. You know, we think about lining the streets and kind of waiting for the people in the parade to give us stuff, right? Now, how many have gone to a parade and what our kids want is the candy, right? You know, and the prizes that people are handing out to us. But that's not why the people came in Jesus' day. They lined the streets out of honor and respect for the people that were coming. But it was a very different feeling from the main gate to the gate that Jesus entered in. And the gate that the main gate had the horses, and it had the dignitaries, and it had the what we call the pomp and the circumstance and all the big parade type things that we might think of like a Macy's Day parade, right? But everyone was quiet at that big parade. There was no shouting. There was no cheering. It was a sign of respect that people would sort of stand there and make a path and just be silent. As the parade of political and religious leaders went by. So what a different feel when you go to the gate that Jesus entered by, where there are no horses. Everybody is walking in, many of them after a 4, 5, 6 day journey on foot. They're dirty, they're tired, they're hungry. But they begin to hear whispers about this man Jesus, who many have heard about but have never seen. This man from Galilee who is going to come in for the Passover festival. They've heard about his miracle healings. They've heard about his confrontational teachings, some that have really conflicted with those of the priests in the temple. They've heard about this man who talks about forgiveness and love and about even loving those who do wrong to us. And they've heard people calling him different things. They've heard people calling him a great teacher. They've heard some calling him a prophet or one who speaks in the name of God. They've heard some people calling him a redeemer. Some even calling him the Messiah, the anointed one, the chosen one that is going to save Israel. So you can imagine sort of the buzz that's beginning in the crowd as Jesus comes in, and he's not walking. But he's not on a horse either. He's not high on the saddle with all the folks around him. He tells his disciples to go and find him a donkey. And we know what donkeys do. Donkeys are very much work animals, you know. They're out there helping in the fields, and they're dirty and they're dusty, and you know, they're just not that high class, high society sort of animal. But Jesus says, yes, this is the donkey that I'm going to ride in on. And he comes in, and the people begin to realize that he's there, and all of the excitement begins to build, and they start to grab cloaks off their back to lay at his feet, and they grab palm branches off of the trees, and they begin to wave them, and they shout this word, Hosanna, Hosanna, which means save me. And it's also a word of praise and adoration. It has multiple meanings in Hebrew. And so can you see the difference, the contrast between the main gate and the gate that Jesus comes in? And all of a sudden, people begin to ask questions. Those who had never seen Jesus before, they start to whisper, who is this? Who is this that's getting so much attention? Who is this donkey rider that's just coming into our city and creating this stir? And there are some people who are believers in Jesus, who have walked with him for 3 years, who are adamantly proclaiming him as Messiah, and there are others who are saying he is our teacher, he's a prophet, he's a healer, There are some that are just plain confused. We don't know what to think of this man. We haven't seen what he's done. We've only heard about it. We haven't seen with our own eyes. But every single person who was there that day had an expectation of Jesus. And sometimes our expectations can get us in trouble. Because sometimes they take us away from seeing what's really there and appreciating who somebody really is. I have a brief video that I want us to watch that talks about what happens when we have some of those false expectations.
The first Palm Sunday, the triumphant entry of Jesus, the Messiah, during a time when his people were under the thumb of the Roman Empire.
When Jesus entered Jerusalem that day,
public opinion was favorable towards him, to say the least. The streets were saturated with people, celebrating, shouting. He was not so excited. His people thought that he was coming to liberate them from the empire. They had an idea, a preconceived notion. They knew what they wanted him to do, what they wanted from him. But they were completely missing the point of the matter. He knew why he was really there. He knew he wasn't quite yet meant to arrive as the political liberator, the conqueror, but instead as the servant who would give his life for a much greater cause. As another Palm Sunday draws near, these 2 millennia later, we would do well not only to remember the events leading up to the Lord's sacrifice, but also to steel ourselves against the mistake his people made the day of his triumphant entry. Let us not be tempted to project our own agenda, our wants, our expectations, our ambitions on God. When we honestly say, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," and truly worship him for who he is, then we will find triumph in every day.
It's very normal as human beings to have expectations of one another. But at this time of year, it's also helpful for us to check and see what are our expectations of Jesus in our life. What do we need Jesus to be? What do we hope Jesus will be in our lives? And when we think about that, what then do we proclaim? Who do we proclaim Jesus to be in our lives? And when we do proclaim Jesus to be something, do our words and our actions match that belief? So if we say we believe that Jesus is our great teacher, are we following what Jesus has taught us to be and to do? If we say that we believe that Jesus is our Redeemer, that we are forgiven of our sins and set free to be God's people, do we live that way? Do we live as free people, forgiven of sin, and telling others what a wonderful and amazing life that can be? And if we say that Jesus is our Savior, do we live that out in our lives? Do we proclaim that to others, that the cross of Christ is actually good news? Not because of the sacrifice and the suffering of Jesus on the cross, but what that did for us for eternity, for the new life that comes through the resurrection that we will celebrate next Sunday. But are we willing to be challenged by God to walk with Jesus, not just in the good times, not just on these days of celebration, but in the trials and the temptations and the crosses we experience in our own lives? Who do we proclaim Jesus to be? Are we taking our palms and waving them high because it's what the in crowd is doing? What seems to be the most popular? Or are we waving our palms because we believe that the one we are waving them to truly is the one who comes in the name of the Lord to forgive, to save, to bless, to give us eternity? Let us take that question with us throughout this Holy Week. And next Sunday, when we come on Easter, let us not hold back our praise, our adoration, our joy for the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.